when I lose my way. I forget my name, remind me who I am. In the mirror all I see is who I don't wanna be. Remind me who I am. In the loneliest places, when I can't remember what grace is. Tell me once again who I am to you, who I am to you. Tell me lest I forget who I am to you, that I belong. Like a stone, and I'm running far from home. Remind me who I am. When I can't receive your love, afraid I'll never be enough. Remind me who I am. If I'm your beloved, can you help me believe it? Lest I forget who I am to you, that I belong to you.
We, you know, masks are preferred, they aren't required, but we do, we are aware that the number of cases in Dodge County hasn't gone down, it's going up still, and so please, please take the time to look out, not just for yourself, but for others. You'll notice whenever I'm around you, I'm going to be wearing a mask because I'm around enough people, I don't know where they've been. So, all right. They got several announcements I'd like to share with you as we begin. And let me begin by just mentioning tonight we started a brown bag picnic, so to speak, as a fellowship time. We've had some people that would come to something outside, they thought, but they're not inside. It's a little sketchy, and plus we got all the rules inside. Anyway, if you're interested in doing that, we invite you to bring your brown bag. We'll meet over at Fremont Park. Hope we get the shelter house again at 5:30, 5:30, 6:30. The purpose of it is merely time together, and I'll have a little bit of a devotional for us, so encourage you to come to that. You can feel free to bring somebody. If you know somebody particularly lonely, it might be a good thing to invite somebody to. And then on Wednesday night is when we're going to do our Zoom fellowship. That'll be 5:30 to 6:30. We still have regular Bible study at 7. But for that one, you need to make sure the office knows so we can get you signed up. There are some people, and this is mainly for the people probably watching today, that are not yet ready to be out. And so we wanted to provide something that somebody with computer access could still have a fellowship time if they'd like to. We're going to do both of those twice a month. And so this will be the last one in July, and then we'll pick up again in August. But that's one of the new things that we have available as we go forward. The vision team met yesterday, and we are going to tentatively, we're going to give it a whirl, but things can change, as you know. But the last Sunday in July, which is two Sundays from now, that's going to be our first Sunday when we're going to go back to normal, have a 9:30 service and an 11 o'clock service, and see how things go with that. So just realize that's coming. We thought we put it out a ways, so there's a little time to announce it, and so you can plan on that. There seemed like there was something else I wanted to tell you too. Let me do this. Since we're not doing an offering time, I guess I should just do it now. Of course, the giving box is back there. That's where we're having you donate, and if you want to donate, we're doing One Great Hour of Sharing right now. But the report yesterday, I just wanted to share with you. I think our church is doing okay. I mean, our expenses have gone down, as well as, you know, the donations that have come in. And so that was kind of an encouraging word to have yesterday. So I just want to share some thanks, appreciation for those folks that continue to support, whether you mail it in or whether you're here to be able to do that. We're doing okay. Keep up the good work. Thank you for being so faithful during such a bizarre time in the life of our church. With that, I think we'll begin our service today. We've got a little video that might just kind of wake us up a little bit, make us think about the day and think about what we need to do as worship begins.
Let your weary spirit rest, lay down. just breathe.
Almighty God, we come today, and maybe our life has been chaos. We certainly feel like the world is right now in so many ways. And sometimes we need to be reminded to just stop, to be in your presence, to breathe in your Holy Spirit, to sit at your feet. So Lord, today as we have gathered, we pray that you'll help us to have a sense of our sitting literally at your feet here in this sanctuary, or at home where we're watching it on television or our computers. That we're at your feet. That we're seeking your guidance, your strength, your comfort, your presence, your power in our lives. Lord, indeed, so many things distract so much. And yet, sometimes we just need to be reminded to stop. So we pause in our daily lives today and gather to worship, to be with you, to be with other believers, to hear your voice, and to seek to do your will. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a couple more songs to enjoy.
Thank you.
salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh,
I don't know about you, it's awful hard to not sing, isn't it, with these songs. I hope that we're at least getting something that's meaningful. We've run across a number of really cool things that we've tried to share, but even while I'm watching them, I find myself going, oh, I'd really like to sing along. But, you know, it's a protection thing. And I think, as they say about a lot of things, this too shall pass, right, at some point. Then we'll get back to a different way of doing things. I did like that line in there, a good reminder, because he lives, about, you know, no need to fear. I know who holds the future. And I think that's important for us right now as well. Prayer requests and some things. I first want to share with you a letter that, or an email that came from Larry Stanton. You may remember Larry. He was here, about a year or two ago, and was going to be here, he and Rebecca both, for our mission conference in August. However, yesterday one of the things we also decided was, well, we probably shouldn't do that yet, and we'll have to see what we do and when we do. It's all in flux. You know, some churches, by the way, are already singing and doing things. Some churches aren't even open. Some are just now opening. We're kind of trying to find a late middle ground. We're trying not to get ahead of things, but we also are trying not to fall too far behind. But we are trying to be cautious. And so the mission conference is going to be a casualty, at least in August, of that. We may do something later. Anyway, Larry's letter says this. For the second time in my missionary career, I find myself stuck in Illinois, unable to return to the people I serve. 6 years ago, the Ebola epidemic prevented our return to Liberia, and we waited 4 long months until International Ministries reassigned us to Hungary. My mother-in-law just found an old journal we published during that time. It was heartbreaking to read and relive the frustration I felt back then. And now, 4 months into the COVID quarantine, we wait again. What does a refugee worker and firewood distributor do in quarantine? Wait, pray, do yard work, cook for the family, read the news. 2 days ago, there was a riot, and I don't remember what date he sent this, but this would have been within about the last week or so, I think. 2 days ago, there was a riot in the Serbian capital of Belgrade, where I've worked in refugee soup kitchens. The rioters weren't refugees, but locals, angry because the government announced they will reimpose strict curfews and rules for combating the resurgence of COVID. Every day I can read about refugee camps still swollen with, quote, huddled masses yearning to breathe free, unquote. All across Europe and the Middle East, people are still seeking refuge from war and poverty. And now with COVID, they are in even more danger and even less wanted. Christian brothers and sisters, please pray for me. Pray that Europe reopens its borders with the U.S. and allows us to return in August. Pray that the girls' passports that we applied for months ago will be ready. Pray for the Hungarian schools planning to reopen in September. Pray for Serbia, suffering through this crisis without aid from the European Union. Pray for the refugees in camps without sanitation and the ability to social distance or receive quality medical care when needed. We are thankful. We are grateful to Rebecca's mom who has taken us in yet again. We're thankful for the churches and individuals who faithfully fulfill their pledges to international ministries. We are thankful for your prayers for us and for those we long to return to, those who still need our caring touch. Thank you. And we remain confident that the God who called us into service, the God who created the heavens and the earth, is still on the throne, still lovingly caring for us and this world, even when it doesn't look like it. His kingdom is both here and coming. And amen, Larry Stanton. I just wanted to share that with you. I know a lot of you know him, and some of you may be supporting him, and Rebecca. And they did tell me, by the way, that if we end up not having them come this year, if that all falls apart, as it sounds like it may, because they're still planning on going back in August, that they put us first on the list for next August. So we may just look to doing that. Anyway, so that's one of the prayer requests to share. I have a number of prayer requests to pass on, or things. We've had a lot going on with folks in our congregation lately. Friday, Melissa Matura's father, had passed away a few months ago in the COVID stuff. They had his service on Friday, so I'll be praying for Melissa. Mary Lamberty had a knee replacement surgery this week and is doing well, or as she said, the physical therapist said, as well as can be expected, right? It's not an easy thing. Esther Bechtel and Red are still out at Legacy, and they're making the progress, you know, as they can. Red is out of his boot that he was in, so his walking is better. Esther, they meet with the doctor this coming week to evaluate again with her broken arm. They don't have a release date yet, but Esther wanted to make sure that everybody knew that she appreciates the love and support and thanks you so much for the cards that have been sent to them. Then Ron McKenzie on Tuesday meets with his oncologist. He's in the hospital now and has been, and they haven't quite figured out everything yet. And so hopefully Tuesday they'll find out some things. It's kind of troubling, the whole process, and it's uncertain. So be in a special prayer for them on Tuesday. Jeff's knee replacement this week went well. Cliff Hammond had surgery on his carpal tunnel on Friday, and he's doing well as well. And then point out that this coming Saturday at 10:30 here in the sanctuary, we are going to have a memorial service for Tamara Chandler, who also passed away during this COVID time. And so if you'd like to come be part of that, you would be welcome to do that. Those are the prayer requests that I have to share with you. That's a lot. And there's some that are I didn't speak and some that you haven't spoken. Let's speak them to God, shall we? Just take the time and let's bow before him as we do that. And I tell you what, when we get done, let's also close in the Lord's Prayer, even though it's not in the bulletin. Let's do that. Let's bow together. Almighty God, first we come and ask you to hear us in the quietness of our own hearts. Lord, we come as the First Baptist Church here in Fremont before you, aware that in our midst, in our congregation, we've had a lot of suffering, hardship, and grief, especially in the last year. We've seen great saints go to join you there at the throne. We've seen people undergo serious medical treatment and come out well. We've seen others struggle and uncertain as how things proceed and progress. And we've also seen, Lord, that with all the stuff going on around us, that the ministries we've been able to do have altered radically. Lord, we ask you to continue to move in our midst. We thank you for opportunities we've had during this time to share your love with folks, but there's many more who need to know that love. Lord, we would pray that these that we've mentioned who've had surgery and are in recovery or who are grieving or who just have some illness that they've wrestled with, that you would be near to each of them, that it would be you that would strengthen their bodies in a way that only you can, and in a way that brings glory to you. And Lord, we commit to your spirit, each one of them, that you'll give them peace and reassurance and endurance as they go physical therapy or the various treatments that they face. Help them to sense you walking with them each step of the way. Today, Lord, we're going to remember you in communion. And as we prepare for that, we pray together the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And as we get ready to look into the message part, make sure you check and see if you have communion supplies. If you don't, they'll be in the little white cup there. If you don't, we'll make sure you have some before we take communion in a few minutes. The ushers will help with that. But just take time now to make sure. So we're doing communion today. And I thought, you know what, I want to focus on that. Every once in a while I like to do that, even with the message. And it's such a familiar practice in our churches. And I think it becomes so familiar that sometimes we don't pay attention to the details. In our church, in a lot of most Baptist churches that I've been at, you know, communion we really only do once a month. There are other churches and traditions that do it every week or every time they gather. And I don't know how they manage to keep it from becoming so rote that they lose the meaning. Even with us, you know, once a month you get so used to how it's done. Sometimes we forget things about what it is. We don't watch the details. And if you're like me, I always like communion to be kind of a reflective time, you know, a time that's filled with all sorts of memories and meanings and some time for some soul searching and confession. But I don't know that I always hear or notice all the pieces involved. And maybe I should. So this week, I was preparing for today's service, and one of those details kind of popped out at me. And I thought, you know what, today I'm gonna focus on that as we gather together. The title of the message is, What Did You Say? And that's kind of an odd title for communion, but I want you to think about it as we go through this. You'll understand why I said that. The passage that we're going to use is the one that I regularly read for communion services out of 1 Corinthians 11. I choose that passage because I think it's a very succinct way of saying the things. It's worded well. And yet over the years, I've noticed there's a lot in this passage that we don't pay attention to. And I'm going to highlight something in the passage when we get to it here in a few minutes. I suspect that if I ask most of us what communion is about, what is it for us, what is the purpose of it, I think probably most of us would say something about remembering Jesus and what he did for us on the cross, or we would talk about being a time of confession, or maybe a renewing our commitment to Christ, or maybe in some traditions, and I think it's a good notion, some of us might think in terms of spiritual nourishment, that the Spirit of God is nourishing us in this time, or a time that's communing with one another and with God. I wonder, though, if we've seen what the passage today says as we begin from 1 Corinthians 11, starting at 22. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. That part we often hear. I mean, it's often on our communion tables, you'll see that written. But it goes on. In the same way also, he took the cup after the supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You ever thought about communion as a time when you are proclaiming? Kind of different, isn't it? Kind of a different, I mean, we think in terms of receiving communion or participating in communion, not proclaiming in communion, right? We may think about the notion that, well, we take it publicly, and so therefore we're reaffirming our relationship to Christ, our Savior. We can think of it as this is a public demonstration of our faith, right? Or maybe we just think of it as, you know what, this is a special time for me to go back, examine myself, as that passage says further on. And in the midst of it, I use it as a time of recommitting to Christ. I know I do that. I'm sure many of you do as well. But that's not what this part of the passage says. It says, we proclaim his death when we take communion. Now, if you were in a Catholic church, you would know that every Mass, whenever they celebrate communion or Eucharist, as they call it, there's that moment when the priest says, let us proclaim the mystery of our faith, and the people all respond, Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. So every time they celebrate Mass, they make a proclamation, and that's the core of it. He has died, he's risen, he's come again. But it doesn't say here, we proclaim his death and he will rise and that he's coming again. It says proclaim his death. Now I wonder, what other religion is based on, has at the core, glorifies, honors, celebrates the founder's death? That's our big deal. The founder died. You know, usually in great religions, you'd like to celebrate the founder's teachings, or the great things he did, or maybe the miracles or his deeds. And Jesus certainly was a great teacher, and he did a lot of good things, and his character was irreproachable, and the miracles, of course, were amazing. Some of them, the mightiest deeds he ever done in history, were done on those days when Jesus ministered. But that's not what we're proclaiming and celebrating in communion. In this passage, it says, his death. We proclaim his death. We don't merely remember Jesus like we always, you know, in remembrance of me, do this in remembrance of me, but we're doing it in remembrance of him because he died. His death. In communion, we are proclaiming his death, not his miracles, not his teachings, not his divinity even, and not even the resurrection, his death. And it's a silent proclamation that we do in unison as we celebrate communion. So I thought some about that. We proclaim his death. You know, he suffered in awful ways, right? A torturous death. And that awful death illustrates the ugliness that sin is in our lives. You know, many of you have watch The Passion, and you come to that movie, The Passion. You come to the moment when they're crucifying Jesus and flogging Jesus, and it's so graphic that you turn away. But we're told, don't turn away, turn to. You know, we need to see how Jesus' death was so gruesome, because our sin is gruesome. We need to see and understand. We look toward it. We lift our eyes to the cross, not away from the cross, so that our sin can be forgiven and we can be saved. His death, we proclaim his death. His death, we're proclaiming that the price was paid. His death, that the ultimate purpose in Jesus coming to earth was but to die for you and for me. His death, a sacrifice, the perfect sacrifice, the final sacrifice, the divine sacrifice, once for all. His death is our life. His death is our hope. His death in place of ours. His death that sealed the new covenant. His death, that pivotal moment in history that resulted in the transformation of my life and of your life today. His death, the power of God appropriated for us. His death is the righteousness of God credited to us. His death is the mercy of God poured out upon us. His death is the grace of God lavishly given to us. His death is the victory of God shared with us. Like in Corinthians 15, where it says, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because he faced death and conquered it. His death. But now I'd be wrong if I stopped there in this passage. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death. But then there's another phrase. Until he comes, right? How can someone who is dead be going to come? Right? It doesn't merely say that he is dead. It says we proclaim his death and that he did experience death. But the fact that he is coming is implicit in that is that he is no longer dead. That he's the living one. He's alive and he's expected. As it's described in Revelation, fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. And I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come. We're celebrating communion today. And as we do that, we're issuing a proclamation. A proclamation before anyone who would observe us, a proclamation that we share with anybody that we would tell about today, then the proclamation is Jesus died. It was a real death, a real sacrifice that it took for you and me to gain entrance to glory. One of the commentators said, the ordinance is a visible one, a preaching of the entire church in silent ministry. To celebrate it properly, you must make a profession of your faith. He died for my sin. He died for your sin. He gave his all. He gave his very life, and he died as the greatest hero of all time, although nobody knew it at the time. He completed his mission. He didn't shrink back, though he was sorely tempted there in the garden, wrestled with what he was asked to do. And yet he walked the path that God had prepared for him so that heaven would be open for you and I to walk through in our time as well. Now we celebrate communion supper, but there will come a day when Jesus returns. And this holy meal that we do, this shadow of a heavenly reality will fade away. Because we'll be ushered into the ultimate reality. We won't need this anymore. Today in this communion service, we look backward to remember Christ and to proclaim his death But we also look forward in anticipation of Christ, proclaiming that pivotal moment when he died until he comes, for we know that he will return. And one day we no longer celebrate this because it's a foretaste of the messianic banquet, and when we're there, we won't need this. We'll have the ultimate banquet before God. When he gathers his people in his arms, he stands with us in that throne room of the Almighty, and we declare with the saints of old, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Today, let's proclaim his death, because his death has changed our lives. Let's pray. Almighty God, you know, I think no matter how many times we've celebrated communion, no matter how many times we've read those scriptures, and studied about them, heard sermons about them, I think there's just so much more to this than we even know. Lord, as we take this communion cup today, help us in the midst of it to have a sense that by taking this, we're proclaiming that Jesus' death on that cross has made a difference for us. That it is the one thing that is our hope in this life and in the life to come. In Jesus' name, amen. Is there anybody that needs communion supplies? Does everybody have some? Okay, I need one down here at the front. Would one of you guys run? Randy, there's some out here in the foyer out on that side. We need some more upstairs, Paul? Okay. Right here for the Christian sins where we need them, Randy. I think everybody else is good. Thank you. Anybody else? Yep, we're good. Thank you. So this little thing is a little tricky, but there's two layers to it. There's the purple tab and there's a clear tab on top of the purple tab. The clear tab you pull first, that'll open you up to the bread. And then you'll take that, and then below it you pull the other tab, and that gives you the juice. We got a song we're going to play called "Torn," just as a song to reflect and meditate as we share together in communion. You take it at your leisure during the song, and we bless this cup and what it means for our lives. Paul. Let's pray, shall we? Mighty God, we thank you that we have a death to proclaim that has saved our lives, that has saved our souls, that all that's dead within us, as the song says, can be reborn. When our faith is weak, when our hopes are dashed, when our future feels uncertain, help us, God, to turn to you, to see you. Help us to see redemption win in our lives each and every day. Lord, I pray for the people of this church. In all the struggles that exist in some homes and the hopes that are in others and the frustrations during this time when we can't go see friends and family, Lord, I pray that you would carry us through. Fill us afresh with your Spirit. Use us where we are. Draw near to us where we are and help us to hear your voice in a fresh way during a strange time of life. Help us to see redemption win right where we're at. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is a little more familiar for many of you, but it also focuses on the cross. As we leave, I want to remind you we are still not serving coffee and cookies. Encourage you to fellowship outside, remember social distancing, hopefully. And then I also want to mention several times we've talked over recent weeks about Milton Pocup, and he's on hospice now. Jill is here today, and so if you if you want a personal update, maybe you could just kind of hang there a little bit if we're somewhere where people don't run off too fast, because some people may want to ask. Have a good week. God bless you. See you next week.